Here we go. Okay, warning. There's going to be some opinions ahead. Without genuine concern, this is all worthless. This is from one of the best military books I've ever read. By the Passion of Command by Colonel B.P. McCoy, the Marine, wrote a fantastic book about commanding.
You want answers? I'll give you the title.
Man, the volume said.
You want answers? I'll give you the title. You want answers?
I want the truth!
Well, I think you can handle the truth, so we're going to go through that. Cody, is the sound working, brother?
Yeah.
Okay, well, this is who I am. My real name is Danny Blitz. I used to be Daniel Philpott, but I changed my name. My lovely wife back here didn't like the name Philpott either. It was an embarrassing name, so anyway, I changed my name. I was fairly famous in the music business under Danny Blitz. I've got 20 plus years of systems build and management. I build military systems, banking systems, medical systems, entertainment systems. I get hired for that because I live like this. I'm currently a software manager of AP and Interactive. Herding cats. Now, this is the common description we have trying to describe the chaos of software development. Now, so this is what you guys look like to me when I first see you. That's the baleful stare of our programmer that doesn't want to be told what to do. But I was actually herding drum cats because I had a band on the road. So this was my life. Scorpions. I got a fan of it from Germany already, so. Yeah, you get it. Anyway, so yeah, I was in a band. I'll show you some junk I was doing while I was building systems. This is a poster from the wall of the whiskey. After I survived two brain cancer operations, I have a tumor in my head. That's probably why I act like I do. So yeah, I got sick. I stopped playing guitar. And during that time, I did quite a few things. I had songs on the Osbournes. I had to deal with Sony Television. I wrote songs for Dawson's Creek. Budweiser was our sponsor, which was quite dangerous for me. Also, E! Television shot a wild episode on me called Hollywood Rocks. And they aired it while I was in my hospital bed. I signed my deal with Miramax in my hospital bed as well. So the only thing that worked on me was my right eye and my right hand, so I could sign my contracts. The left side of my body was really dead as they cut the tumor out, so that's why my left hand is laying like it is. During this time, I was building systems, though, in parallel so I could keep working. I built systems for the Department of Defense. I lived in Washington, D.C. I was building Foxborough systems. I built Citibank's online banking system and also the branch of the future, which I was in Time Magazine in 1998. I ran the build of the last Ticketmaster system. I built Dell's online HR system. That was the last system I built before I stopped programming. That was 10 years ago. You guys have so much better tools than what I have. I also built Cisco's online consultant site. If you want to find an international Cisco consultant, you can find all the system I built. I was the software director for Quest Diagnostics. I was also on one of the Grand Darker Challenge team who built the robots that could race across the desert. We built the four-wheel drive thing to drive itself. It had all sorts of range finding things so it could see through front of it. It had pattern recognition, artificial intelligence. Pretty freaky. The last system I did before I got to the company out of now, CBS Radio, a huge system that was built in .NET. I know that makes you very excited. I show the new master now, which is AT&T Interactive. I run the Tiger Team program. I started it. Kobe has tolerated me quite well. My boss is Kobe, the guy who did it. Give Kobe a hand. So I think Agile in my view is the only way to develop software. It's the only way that makes sense. And Agile's in trouble, and I want to talk a little about this right now. This is one of the best quotes ever on agility. A good plan violently executed now is better than a perfect plan next week. That's by General Patton. General Patton is a man on the move. There's the man himself. Love that guy. Software development is hard. Let's not trivialize what we do. It is very difficult to build these big systems we build. So why is software development so difficult? I believe it's because people won't admit or accept the truth. Why won't we admit the truth? Well, because we're afraid. We don't know the truth. So we don't know some of these answers. When that CIO or CEO is looking at us and saying, you know, when's this thing going to be done? Blah, blah, blah. We don't know the answer. I'll tell you why. Well, what are we afraid of? We're afraid of it. We don't know when things are going to result. Why don't we know what those new results will be? Well, here's what I think. The business needs change. The new competitors are here, the technology tools change, you guys are making a huge dent now. I see all the new tools you're building, and it's a violently changing landscape underneath us. A new product vision here, you have a guy show you hire a firm building in MySpace, it's going to make you $1 billion, you got to build a new system. So how should we deal with this? Here's what I think. We should just admit the truth and build our process around these issues. So what is a Tiger Team? A Tiger Team is a small, self-improving software team with velocity and quality as primary drivers. I expect them to produce an enormous amount of product in very short time frames with very low or no defects. So how are we going to do this? Well, first of all, start with what can we expect from the Tigers? We've already done this at AEPI. We started our first team live game. In fact, they're here. Our first project was slated for 5 weeks. We finished in 7 days. Our next project was 1 week for the first. We finished in 3 days. We were accelerating. We were growing the process. We were getting better as we were doing it. So as they were learning and moving, they were taking this knowledge and they were transferring the momentum from project to project. So what's different about Tigers? Well, I'll tell you, Tigers are a team. They're a real team. It's not four developers sitting in separate cubes working. These guys actually, they share the love. They pass work to each other. We give them a big blob of work.
Rich Wanda, I'll be using buddy system. No more blinds. Can't somebody watching your back at all times.
So good old Rich Wanda. And I want to show you a photograph. And this is a remarkable photograph. This photograph is a minute, it was a meeting, it was a minute long, this is where the Tigers meet. It's like 1 minute damage. I had to walk up, snap this photo. I didn't stage this photo. What's really remarkable about this photo is who was in it. There's two developers on the left and two QA people on the right. We work very, very closely with QA. The QA people are actually Tigers themselves. They work with us from the very beginning. If we could get them, if we could actually get their attention from the beginning, we'd like to work with them from the beginning. They're also not smiling because I said to smile. They were just having a good time talking about the project. So what else is different about Tigers? Tigers show leadership. I insist upon this. In the group, when I'm working with a Tiger team, I want people to step up and lead, to help me lead things. You know more than I do about what you're doing. You actually understand the API better and whatnot, so I need someone to help me run the team. Now, this model-looking woman here, her name is Jaya. She's actually here today. Jaya is now the leader of Team Lightning, the first team that we built at ATTI. We're building a Tiger team program. We're building initial teams. I couldn't run them all, so Jaya stepped up and became the manager. I'm very proud of her. I work very closely with her still. Because we're very different. Jaya and I'm very sort of like a berserker. I'm like, ah! And she wants to plan and calculate, read the requirements, make a plan, all these different things that I can kind of work with. So. What else is different? Well, Tiger self-improve, a big deal. We improve every single day. We constantly look to get better. Not only are you going to write the system, you're going to get better at writing the system, you're going to get better at execution. And it can be incremental. You don't have to like make these huge moves every day, but if you make a 1% improvement once a day, for 365 days, that's not 365% say in 1 year. That's thousands of percent of compound. So you get to where you move at the speed of thought, just boom, you are moving it. The back phone rings and we know what to do. We have almost no meetings. This is the big thing for me. I hate meetings and it's a bunch of waste of time. So the very first thing I do with the Tigers is don't meet with the Tigers, leave them alone. They're working, we isolate them, we make sure that people leave them alone so they can work. If you call a meeting with our Tiger team, this is the look they're going to get. What? You don't have a meeting. So generally, we don't get a lot of meetings. What else is different about Tigers? QA and test automation are tip of the spear. If I have my way, I have the QA person on the team from the very beginning. I'm restating this because it's so important. When that product person talks to us for the very first time, I want them to be there. I want the QA person to be there in addition to the programmers to listen to what's going on. Because the programmer is listening with the ears that are saying, how can I build this? Well, the devious mind of the QA person is, how can I break this? So they have different questions they ask the product person, because they'll say, have you thought of this or this or this? And prime solicitation is much better. Also, we build a test automation in from the very beginning, so we have essentially a big net in the system to protect us if we blow it up. What else is different? We have a shared psychology and intelligence in these groups. And this is for real. I've watched this happen with Team Lightning for sure. It's a psychology of winning. They expect to win. They just believe they're going to win the game. They're very bold. They're not afraid of much. And the last one's excellence. These groups push each other. They start to, as they work as a team, they're looking at each other's commits, they're seeing how fast they're moving, they become, and they look for excellence. They pair, they do peer reviews, all these things. They just get better and better code. So this is very, very important. So what else is different? They're not afraid of the dark. Well, what I mean by this is, a Tiger team will start on a project knowing almost nothing. We don't have to know a lot. Because, well, obviously, waterfall makes sense. You like to know what you're building before you build it. It just makes sense. You're going to build something, what am I going to build? Well, we know our clients don't have a freaking clue what they want when they come to us to begin with. They don't have a clue what they want to build. They just want it to be blue or cool or you know, something like that. I don't know. So we just start knowing what we know. And I have to ask you, do you look like this when you were afraid of the dark? I don't think so. This is a psychological thing. It's the reason I named my folks Tigers, and this is a military term of respect. So I named them Tigers from the beginning. They are Tigers. I want them to think of themselves as being ferocious, not being just a program sitting in a queue. Who is on a Tiger team? All the staff to deliver our product is the very short answer. I haven't won this battle at our company yet. I only have what I have. I have my piece of the system. What I really need is the full group. I need the developers, sysadmins, DBAs, and everything. I don't have that yet. What I have now, we have a Tiger leader, that's me. We typically have four developers, a good ideal number, because we do a lot of pairing, swarming, and whatnot. Like automation engineer, QA tester, and very, very important that product staff know. I want them in the room because we're asking a lot of questions. We're moving so fast and we're showing so much product. We want to ask the questions right then and there. In addition, you might have architecture, somebody who's overseeing the enterprise architecture of the company and is looking at everything they're building. Sysadmins, DBAs, UI folks, graphic designers, etc. Why worth it? Well, business is battle. Our battlefield is the marketplace. Battle is typically divided into attrition and maneuver. Let's talk about attrition warfare. Attrition warfare is traditional tactical battle, clashing head-on. It's like two large armies grinding against one another. This is the traditional way of battle. You just slug it out for victory. What kind of companies do this kind of battle? Well, Tower Records, who I used to work for, sadly out of business. GM, I think you know your story. Ford. Chrysler. Home Depot. These are all attrition warfare companies. Home Depot's fighting Lowe's and Walmart and whatnot. And it's all, the idea is you're a bigger company, you're going to just crush your company to get more advertising dollars. But I don't think attrition warfare is bad. You've got to hold on to the ground again. And to prove that, I'm going to bring on a great American who was a great attrition warfareist and who really made World War II go. President Eisenhower, who was Patton's boss, an attrition warfareist. Patton was a maneuver warfareist, and Eisenhower was a attrition warfareist. I know what you're thinking.
I know that, dude.
So let's talk about maneuver warfare. Maneuver warfare is the internet space. This is the space we all live in. You guys are, by definition, maneuver warfare is the kind of system you're building. I bet every one of you. Maneuver warfare is rapid, modern, and violent. I'm just saying you're violent people, but anyway, that's what maneuver warfare is all about. It's unexpected movements, things appear that you don't expect. You create a, like the Marines say, a rapidly deteriorating situation for your competition. What companies are good at this? Well, certainly Apple's good at this. eBay, well, AT&T Interactive. I wanted to mention eBay now because AT&T Interactive, that's where I'm for the company. eBay, of course. MySpace, I didn't see that coming. Facebook, also good stuff. So let's talk about the military aspect. The Marines are full maneuver warfarists. They believe in maneuver warfare. They move very fast. And maneuver doesn't mean just moving around. It also means doing unexpected things, you know, like perhaps, I can't give you a full description. And ironically, the warfareists that I'm going to describe here are not Marines. Patton was an Army man. He was actually a general, the general of the Third Army of World War II. And General Sherman, the Civil War. General Sherman was what I consider one of the first maneuver warfareists, because General Sherman decided when he was going to fight the Civil War that the Confederate Army was not his problem. The problem was the aristocracy of the South, the slaveholders. They were creating the problem, they were funding the army. So he just ran straight to the South and said, I'm going to burn all the plantations down and I'm going to free the slaves. So he shot to the South, and of course, as a Southern man, I was raised to believe he was Satan. But in fact, he's a great American. Because the Confederate Army's right here, and there was this guy running through the country, burning it down. So they were running from battlefields to go home. So he saved lots and lots of lives. Another interesting stat about General Sherman was he lost 1% of his men, one. In the Civil War, that is an amazing, amazing low number. It's like nothing. So it kind of makes me feel bad about hating on a gun. So let's talk about people in business. Who are maneuver warfare? See, anyone know who this is? I do not know who this is. I didn't know who this was when I got this picture. This is the founder of eBay, great maneuver warfare. So I shall leave you now with what I think is the greatest maneuver warfare term today. That's Steve Jobs himself. Great man, he has pulled Apple back from the brink. I think highly of him.
Oh Lord, bless this finance grenade, but will it now make it blow like enemies to tiny bricks in my
body? Yeah, you know he says that for every time he drinks with an iPod or an iPhone. God bless him. God bless him. Okay, speed. Let's talk about speed. Speed itself is a competitive weapon. The military says speed is a weapon. It's an undeniable advantage in business. First to market is a huge advantage. As a matter of fact, some consider this the primary rule of business and warfare and marketing. Civil War General Forrest famously said, get there firstest with the most. This was actually a joke quote. He was being faulty because General Forrest was a smart, educated man. He's rich. And he just kind of said this to be kind of faulty. But this is how he operated. General Forrest was crazy. He would ride in a battle on his horse with a 9-shot revolver that had a shotgun barrel down the middle. It's called a little map. A friend of mine has a Civil War with that. It's terrifying, brother. He got horse shot up under him several times and lived through the war. Want to see what it looked like? That's it. It's like, stop. Completely out of his mind. Speed mitigates risk. I hear this nonsense all the time. Speed kills. Speed does not kill. Speed mitigates risk. Speed is no guarantee of no software failures. I mean, we're going to blow it up. I'm going to blow it up. I know I'm going to blow it up. I'm just going to say that right now. But it mitigates the effect of that failure because we're moving so fast. All software processes will have some level of bugs, unmet expectation, and the like. A fast team can create very fast recovery cycles. Essentially, we contained the damage by the very short time it's in existence. Yeah, we blew it up, and it was 2 hours, it was down, that's it. The team just, boom, it's on. We have smooth sailings. Speed improves the team. It gives us more time for process improvement, growing the team's shared psychology and intelligence. Speed has the job satisfaction, reducing the grind of the job. It was a little bit slower when before the Tigers came along. I have to say that I'm very happy we're here now. Time flies when you're having fun.
Woo-hoo!
But I love this little guy so much I'm going to do it twice. Speed allows Agile to function properly. Agile has a spin like an engine. You're surrounded by a high-performance engine, so this should ring true for you. Anyone knows that an engine is not moving at a certain rotational speed, will just stall. The development is too slow, the engine will stall. Virtually all Agile methods refer to a maximum iteration limit. Usually it's 30 days. If you get to a situation where you're programming for, say, 90 days before you show anything, you're not Agile. You're something else. I don't know what you are. You're not Agile. Your engine is stalled. So I just put this up because some nut bar built this 2,000 horsepower twin turbocharged 57 Chevy to terrorize me. Speed builds credibility. This is huge in a big company. For those of you that are in big companies, we have to build credibility with our product staff, our non-technical people. We want to reduce the feeling with them. We don't care about the time sensitive need of the company because we're showing so much work so fast. Boom, 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 boom. They know we're moving. They know things are happening. So what do we want? Well, my cartoon guy says, wow. Let's talk about cows and tigers. A cow is much bigger than a tiger, roughly twice the size of a tiger. So who wins? So in this corner, we have Elsa wearing the black and white trunks. And in this corner, wearing the orange and black, we have Simba. Let's see what Simba has to say now. Well, Simba didn't want to talk to us.
Roar.
We are cool. Thank you for the sound effect. You're using agile terms to describe a non-agile process. This is happening in companies all the time. People will adopt the taxonomy. What happens is somebody on high in the company says, we want to be agile. And so some guy in the company reads a book, he sees the word scrum, and says, oh, we're going to have scrums now. Scrum, 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 scrum. They use the word over and over and over. And it's complete crap. Really thing. So the plain fact is, it makes agile a joke. And it's one of my big pet peeves. If you're doing this, you are not this. You are, in fact, this. I got that from some perennial maniac putting cow tiger got that picture, so great. What's up about the corporate animal? The corporate animal kingdom. As I've done agile projects and I've had resistance, there's a lot of friction towards it. I've encountered various types of people that helped me and got me my way. I'm gonna talk about some of those people. A tiger. Well, a tiger wouldn't be what we are, me and my team of tigers. We are actually pretty cautious as animals go. A tiger wouldn't even attack a human until it's we're calculated. We look to win. We have tremendous ferocity and piss us off. But we avoid unwinnable fights, and we're crazy to do. Let's talk about the cow. Well, the cow is a herding animal, not known for original thought, afraid of risk, and avoids just about everything. These are the type of people they get in like mid-management because they're plotting along with not very controversial characters.
Yeah, hi, it's Bill Lumber. I just want to make sure you knew that it did start at the usual time. Yeah, it's been half day or anything like that. So you could just go ahead and get here as soon as possible.
That's not like a cow to you, it does to me. Let's talk about the bear. The bear is a big, usually mellow creature. They have awesome battlefields. We all know this. They have a live and let live attitude. Typically, bears are pretty mellow creatures. They avoid unnecessary fights. And they make great tiger bosses. I look for a bear. I can't have a cow as a boss because ultimately they smell the fact that I'm a tiger and it scares me and they want to get rid of me. So I need a bear for a boss. So there's a bear that happens when he's hanging out with you. It's like, it's just going to use berries and hang out. But if you poke him with a stick, you get this. But you want to see a human bear? I'll show you one. My boss goes. Well, to Kobe, I gave that jacket to Kobe. We wore them together at Salt Lake. We both wore our orange tiger t-shirts, so we were like, hell's program. Let's talk about the leopard. Now, this is what you don't want to be. Leopards, as animals are, just freaky, fierce animals. They have unmatched ferocity. They are truly wild. They'll fight anything and everything. They're not going to wait to see if it's dangerous. They're just going to attack it. They're not good for a team. Basically, you know, you don't want this guy on your team. I mean, I used to be kind of a leopard. I was basically, I had to learn to calm down and become a tiger and cat, even more silently around. The elephant. The elephant are huge and tough, intelligent, virtually invincible in battle. These are typically sea level folks. You don't want to fight them. This is a good way to lose your job. You don't want this dude staring you down, even if you're a tiger. And the last one, the one that I really hate, the hyena, the scavenger. These are the dangerous weasels. They steal for their food. They're the obstructionists. They get in my way when I'm trying to do something. They will actively campaign against getting things done. So they are evil. That's how that looks like Satan's pet. I just think they're creepy. Let's talk about leadership. This is what's going to make and break it. Leadership is the real deal of tigers. You would think it's odd to talk about faith and love when you talk about leadership. But this is really the thing that makes tigers go. And I say this because faith, I have faith in my team. I go home, I sleep like a baby at night. I know for a fact the work is going to get done. I simply do not worry about it one bit that these guys are getting this work done. I have absolute faith in them. They have faith in me as a leader that I'm going to do everything I can possibly do to give them a good work situation. And I love them. These are my battle buddies. They're my brothers and sisters. And also hope. Let's talk about hope. Now, has anyone ever worked in a place where there was no hope? I have. I've worked in a place where it was just never going to get better. I think we can pretty much also have been there. It was just never going to get better. Well, you might as well get your resume ready if that's happening. So I say, this is a deal I made with my team. Success belongs to the team. If you succeed, the success all belongs to you. You get the credit. All the failure, if you fail, if you blow it up, I'll take the blame. I'll go to the president's office and say, I did it. I blew it up. I have absolutely no problem with that. So it's a fear reduction strategy, my guys. Just, they know they're not going to get in trouble. The buck stops here. So who said that? The great Harry Truman. Fearlessness. Now, I'm not actually fearless. I may appear to be kind of, I'm certainly loud, but I'm not actually fearless. The Marines describe two types of bravery. What I am is brave, because I'll do it anyway. I'm scared, but I'll do it anyway. The Marines describe two types of bravery. There's the stoic, reasoned kind of bravery, where you reason and calculate you're going to win. That's Kobe. Then there's the sort of frenetic, fierce bravery that I am, sort of emotion-based. So if you're going to be a leader, you better be this and not be this. If you say you're a leader and you're tired of your little kitty cat, well, you're just not a good leader. You guys are smart, I heard. You have to be a listener and learner. That's a big deal. I always ask my team what I can do to make their job better. I always talk to them about it constantly. What can I do? What can I do to improve your work life? You know, I'm not a guy who thinks he knows everything. I know I don't know everything. I go in knowing that I'm going to listen to what my team has to say. I'm a protector of my team. This is a big, big deal. This is what I first had to do. First, an outside influence. That's the ridiculous numbers of meetings my team. Let's have a meeting and discuss this for a 9-hour hour. If you take 5 people in a room and have a 2-hour meeting, that's 10 hours of programming time gone. That's a lot of programming time. So I simply stop that from happening. Internally in the team, on occasion, you'll get a problematic rock star who is a pain in the ass for everybody else, and you have to protect the team from them. You actually just have to straighten the problem out. So also, the team members themselves. Now, this doesn't happen often, but on occasion, I've had guys get on my tiger feet, and they just flip out. They're so excited about how much work they do, they just go crazy. When I was on CBS Radio, this happened. I was working in the SAG building once in Wilshire. There's a lot of famous people coming in and out. So I was going weekends to see what was there. It's kind of fun. And I would go there, and my team members were there. Like all of them. I mean, I finally said, you guys, really, it's Sunday. You guys are at Disneyland or something. Freaking me here. So let's talk about the U.S. Marines management techniques. Now, the U.S. Marines have published a book called Core Business. It's called the Marine Corps, COPS, Core Business. They talk about 30 management techniques they use to have an effective fighting. Now, I've adopted 4 of them because a number of the techniques are about killing people. I haven't had to do that yet. I manage by instinct and intent. I do not micromanage my team at all. Basically, I say, there's where we're going. Here's the plot of work. Get there. I don't micromanage them at all. They know more than I do what they're doing. So the Marines are the same way. They don't have an idea what they're doing. I reward failure. What I say about this is I have a mistake-friendly environment. If you make a mistake, no one on the team is going to know. I'm certainly not going to do it. No one else is going to point at you and say, man, you made a mistake, all that childish crap. I don't give up. No finger pointing. I mean, I mean that. It's one of those things that programmers like to do that just annoys the hell out of me. I demand to be questioned. The bottom line with this is, you know, I want programmers to tell me what they want. And programmers are not typically verbal people. And of course, yeah, I don't know what else to say about that. This is the big one, glorifying the lower levels of the organization. This is the really big one. In the Marines, the grunts are more important than the generals. You guys are the one getting the work done. I mean, the muckety mucks, yeah, you're up there, they're doing, I guess, the work stuff, probably coming to whatever, but you're really getting things done. And this is how I see it, this is how the Marines see it. I think it's really right on. Let's talk about politeness and professionalism. This is a disease in software engineering. Now, I'm not pointing to any of you, because I don't know any of you that well. I mean, I know some of my team over here. You got it all great. But politeness and professionalism, the lack of politeness and professionalism, somehow we get out of kindergarten or whatever, we get out of high school and we start programming, and we say, well, that can be a jackass to everybody, because I know we. Well, that's wrong. As a matter of fact, I'll give you an example. The Marines, if you're they are a killing machine. But if you are impolite or unprofessional, they will not only throw you in jail, they'll put you in hard labor. It's very funny because I worked with a Marine sniper. He said to me, they make you make big rocks into little rocks all day long. They make you carry your sledgehammer all the time if you are impolite or unprofessional. It's a big deal. Because without politeness and professionalism, you get poison in the air. Very important to have this. And I'll talk about Agile itself. Agile is not a methodology. It is not a methodology. It's something else. Agile is a mindset. It's a way of thinking. And Agile is inevitable as well. I've worked on mainframe systems, every COBOL systems that have been, every one I've ever seen has been refactored, rebuilt, changed every way to Sunday, features ripped out of them, put back in, you know, new features added. So it's inevitable anyway that you're going to have to go through iterations on any system since the beginning of computer science is true. So that's true about Agile. Do you want more info? Well, you are in luck. In fact, you're really in luck today. I've written a manual. This has only been available in our company, but I actually have a few copies of me today. I'll sell you one. I'm writing a full-length book on the subject. I made the mistake of not bringing it before. I got in pretty good trouble. It's all right. HurryTigers.com is a site we have up. I don't have a lot of time to work on it because I'm actually writing the book. And you can also write me at the end of HurryTigers.com and yell at me and tell me I'm full of crap. So any questions? Are you all pinned back in your seats?
Sir, yes, sir.
That's right, soldier. It's not all you got a pair. That's Marley Irving I was going to put in there. There were so many curse words I had to pick it up. You are abuse. You are nothing.
Question.
Okay.
I have a question.
Oh, yeah.
So I noticed that you have an automation engineer. What exactly does that person do?
Automation engineer runs a test suite that goes underneath. It's kind of, well, we operate in TV as well. We write tests ahead of the code. The automation engineer writes a big, we use things like cruise control. We write all these code suite underneath our main code that is running to check it. And essentially, we push a commit. It runs like thousands of tests. So you can literally, once we get to 100% code coverage, which is my friend Reed told me that we've gotten this a couple times, you can rip a feature out kind of willy-nilly. And if something breaks, it'll fall into the net, and you'll immediately. So that's how it works. Yes, sir.
I've heard said that there's three different requirements on software development, or any project for that matter. You can have it fast, you can have it cheap, or you can have it well done.
That's true, yes.
And how do you manage the quality? Because you're already going for speed.
Yeah.
And so you know, how do you grow the quality and how do you grow the quality of your team, whereas you still are trying to do it cheap?
You need it in from the very beginning. You hear about quality process. I mean, I've had Six Sigma training now. I don't know if Six Sigma is a good way to stop all work altogether, but quality, it used to be the fast, good, cheap, pick two was the way. But now we know that quality and velocity are tied together. You actually get better if you are fast. By building it in. When you build QA and test automation from the beginning, you can be very, very fast. And when your brains are fresh, you run through the thing, and you get quality and velocity, and that's the whole trick here with this notion of flipping QA from the end to the beginning. Yes?
Bob Martin had some interesting things to say about the big rewrites, and he pulled out the example of the Tiger Team kind of as a negative in the following way. If you're not on the Tiger Team, then you're one of the not as good people being left behind by your organization. So how do you really deal with that as far as avoiding the negativity of those who aren't part of your Tiger Team and bringing them into the fold?
They should join the Tiger Team. We have five. As a matter of fact, I'm glad you mentioned that, because I actually have a spot on Team Thunder available now at ATTI. So you come talk to me if you need a job. Sometimes you're needing a job. So we actually have a spot now, which is pretty rare. I'll be your king tiger. Yes, sir.
You guys ever have some downtime? It seems like you guys are coming fast all the time. Do you worry about burnout?
I watch for that. I mean, like I said, I'm a protector of my team. That's why the third point is so important. I watch for that. I mean, I can have guys get flipped out and just go, 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 go. But I'm also very quick to say, oh, you're time to go home. I mean, my guys all say it. a lot of tired people over here. And I'll tell you that, you know, I don't push them at all. The truth is, they push themselves. I just stand back and go, wow, holy crap, that's a lot of code. But if I see them starting to really get exhausted or anything, then I'll say, pull a break. Let's go to Disneyland. I mean, I'm really big on that. I'm really big on keeping everybody happy. Uh-oh, the alarm bell's gone off, so I'm done. Thank you so much.